name is Ramanujam. I'm from this institute, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all to this evening's public lecture by Niruj Mohan Ramanujam. And today's lecture is on the 150th anniversary of the discovery of helium. And that was somewhere very close by of the Madras state of those days in Guntur and Machilipatnam. That's a very interesting story, and Niruj is here to tell us. So let me welcome you all. Niruj is did his PhD in astronomy from Raman Research Institute and Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And then he was working in University of Leiden in the Netherlands, and he's been in National Center for Radio Astronomy in Pune. He's a radio astronomer and a great science popularizer. He has been popularizing astronomy from a very early age, I think from when he was in school, if I remember right. And he's done enormous amount of outreach activities, and currently he's with the public outreach activities of the Indian Astronomy Association, Astronomy Union, Astronomer Society of India. And he's also told me to tell you that he's jobless, and anyone who wants to offer him a job, he's ready to do. So it's a pleasure to introduce Niruj, and he's going to tell us about the history of helium.
Thanks, Jam. I know Jam since long back when I was in school. He used to drag me to Tamil Nadu Science Forum activities and make me bring my telescope along. So if I'm doing all this, it's partly Jam's fault. So what you're seeing here, can you put these lights off? Okay. What you're seeing here is a video from the SDO spacecraft of NASA of the sun's surface. This is a huge prominence which erupted at some point a few years ago. And this is basically plasma which is flowing along the magnetic fields of the sun. And at some point you see a small dot here which is the size of the Earth for comparison. I just left it here just to give you an idea of how violent the sun is and what happens in the sun, and we'll come to it over the course of the talk. So my talk is about, as Jam said, tomorrow is the 150th anniversary of the discovery of helium, which happened in Machilipatnam and Guntur in present-day Andhra Pradesh. And it also kind of, the story of the discovery of helium is not just interesting because of the science part of it, but also interesting from a sociological part, the history of science and astronomy and so on, and also history of other branches of physics. It also talks of intrigue, rivalries, and things like that. But it also marks the beginning of spectroscopy in some sense in astronomy, and what I would term fingerprinting of the universe, which I'll talk about towards the very end. There's also a take-home gift for all of you. There's some printouts kept here and here where you can make your own small spectroscope using a CD you don't like anymore. Once you make it, it looks like this. You can download the file and print it yourself. It's open source material. So before you go, you can take one copy. You can see, for example, spectra of incandescent sources. You can see if you put salt in a candle, and you can see the sodium lines. You can see the dark lines we could point towards the sun, at least the hydrogen line, and so on. And just to make sure that you stay here till the end of my talk, we kept it here for you to take after. Yeah, you can see it here from here too. So, you know, so when you leave, you can pick up a copy. You can download the file and print as many as you want later as we go along. So I'm a member of the Public Outreach Education Committee, the POEC of the ASI. The POEC was formed in 2014 with a mandate to promote awareness and interest in astronomy across the country. Okay, so the history of helium, like I said, is linked to the history and the development of chemistry, optics, atomic theory, and astronomy in the 1800s. But it's also linked to sociology. It's linked to heroes and villains. It's linked to colonialism and imperialism. It's linked to politics, personalities, rivalries between scientists, fights, debates over credit. It's also linked to amateur astronomers and professional astronomers and how what their roles were. It's also linked to, you know, insight and hard work, collaboration across countries and across warring nations, and it's also linked to graciousness as well as rivalries. And we'll see all of that in this story. Okay. So what do we know? Let's take a recap of what we know now, looking back 150 years. We know the periodic table. You've seen all this in school. And they all differ by atomic number, which is number of protons. Helium sits here with an atomic number of 2, and our story is about helium. It belongs in the column called noble gases or inert gases because they don't react with anything else very easily. We also know now that the universe is made of 3/4 by mass of hydrogen and 1/4 of helium. So helium is 1/4 of the entire universe. The remaining 1% is made of everything else we know. All the other elements we know is typically combined roughly 1% of what the universe is made of. Okay? The sun, which is the nearby star, is a star. We know that it's held together by a balance of self-gravity and gas pressure. The gas pressure is caused because of nuclear fusion in its core, where protons combine to form helium. The story of helium in the core has nothing to do with the story of helium we are going to hear today, though. It has an identifiable surface called the photosphere, which is what you see with the naked eye when you look at the sun. And a surrounding atmosphere called the chromosphere, and a surrounding thing called the corona, which extends much, much farther. Okay, you can see the corona during total solar eclipses. And these red things you see are real. The red things are called prominences or flares. These are basically stuff like this, which erupts out of the solar surface and travels to Earth over a couple of days and causes disruptions in our telecommunication and so on. But basically, the sun is a violent place with a lot of things happening. If you look at the sun through a telescope very carefully, by projection, you will see there are dark spots called sunspots on the surface. And therefore, it's a strange place with a lot of things happening in it. Okay. What do you know about helium now? We know helium is the second lightest element after hydrogen. Its nucleus has two protons and two neutrons. A neutral helium has two electrons going around it. It has no odor, no color, no taste. It's an inert or noble gas. It does not react with anything. We are yet to find a molecule involving helium because it reacts so less with any other element. And therefore, it also liquefies at 4 Kelvin. It liquefies at very low temperatures, whereas a superconductor and a superfluid. It was produced during the Big Bang in copious quantities and also inside stars like our sun. It makes up almost a quarter of the universe by mass, and it's very, very rare on Earth, but it's found everywhere else in the universe. And all of these properties play an important role in the story we're going to see today. It's used a lot in balloons, but also in superconducting magnets, for example, MRI machines, which I've seen a lot of personally, and CERN for the Large Hadron Collider, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now let's go to the story of helium itself. The official story is this. Even now, if you look at Wikipedia or look at any other page online, the official story, for example, said by Ramsay in his Nobel Prize speech for discovering helium on Earth, says the existence of helium was demonstrated by Janssen during a spectroscopic examination of the solar chromosphere in 1868 while making observations on an equatorial sun in India. Okay, this is wrong. The story was set straight in a brilliant book, a very good book called The Story of Helium and the Birth of Astrophysics by Biman Nath, who is a faculty at the Raman Research Institute in Bangalore. It was published in 2013. So it took a long, long time for the true story to be, the actual story of this discovery to be set right. Okay, and I'm going to tell you why this confusion happened. And this talk is primarily based on his book. And I checked online, Math Science does not have a copy of this book, so I strongly suggest that Math Science does purchase a copy of this book. It's a really great book on the history of science. So let's start at the very beginning. Greeks and Indians, we know, had some concept of what they called elements. For example, earth, water, fire, air, and also atoms. For example, Democritus had a concept of atoms. Vaisheshika and Jaina schools in India had concept of atoms. But these are theology-based, and they were not based on any experiments or measurements, and therefore they got all the details wrong, all the predictions were not correct. For example, Aristotle's theories, for example, about elements and atoms were spectacularly wrong, right? But that was what was thought of for centuries and centuries. Still, modern science came on the picture and insisted on actual experiments and measurements to actually find out what's happening. And by weighing chemicals before and after chemical reaction, and by electrolysis using voltaic piles, chemists then did discover more about what these atoms actually were, right? So for example, these names which you heard, which you know from your school textbooks like Boyle, Dalton, Lavoisier, Davy, and even Faraday, were the ones who kind of figured out through experiments using electrolysis and careful measurements of weights that all chemicals are made of specific elements which combine in particular ratios and so on and so forth, right? This is actually a page from Dalton's book where he lists all the known elements of his time with the symbols he had devised, okay? And by 1835, and this all this happened in the early 1800s, and by 1835, they knew 55 elements. They knew them as unique and distinct. But why do you have 55? Why not less? Why not more? All the atomic weights of elements seem to be integral multiples of hydrogen. Therefore, hydrogen seemed to be like the primal matter out of which everything was made. But then chlorine was not integral multiple. Chlorine was 35.5. So a lot of confusion about what elements were, what they composed of, and so on in the early 1800s. Now, let's move to astronomy a bit and come back to chemistry a bit later. Von Fraunhofer of Bavaria in Germany, he was an illiterate man, he was apprenticed to a glassmaker, and he was a genius in making glass instruments. Okay, he was well known for making some of the best achromatic lenses in Europe at that time. He invented the spectroscope as we know it, as well as the diffraction grating. He, in 1814, using the prism spectroscope he had invented, looked at the spectrum of the sun. And you know, Newton, of course, famously had done this long, long back, and he had dispersed the sunlight into a rainbow of colors and said, ha, look, white light is composed of colors and so on. But he, Fraunhofer with the spectroscope, found that in between this rainbow of colors of the sun were dark lines. Okay, they are now called Fraunhofer lines in his honor. And because he had a spectroscope, he could measure the angles and therefore the wavelengths of these lines, dark lines, well. So this stamp is actually, in his honor, is actually a reproduction of his diagram, which he had painted, of these dark lines, which he saw. He had identified some 574 lines in his work. Okay, of these dark lines, which were threading the entire rainbow spectrum from the sun. Of course, he had no idea what they were. And except that he knew that if you burn most things in a flame, some of the bright lines which you saw when you burn things in a flame in the lab seem to correspond to some of the dark lines he saw on the sun. But how are they connected? He had no clue. Okay. This is a current picture of the solar spectrum with all the Fraunhofer lines you could see with this resolution. And you can see that the solar spectrum is completely studded with these dark lines from beginning to end. Okay. Now we know what they are. But that time they were a huge mystery. And these are called Fraunhofer lines. And you can see at least the hydrogen line with the spectroscope you build from the sheet you're going to take back today. Okay. A few years later, John Herschel, whose father was William Herschel, who had discovered Uranus, and Talbot had noticed that different substances seemed to give different kind sets of lines in the lab, in the flame. Okay. And Talbot thought that these were connected, and therefore he thought maybe you could infer which substance you had from the lines they emitted. But he wasn't sure. He said maybe you could do this. Right? He thought that. This is the early 1800s. In 1830, Brewster, who we also know from our optics textbooks, he superposed the spectrum of the sun, to the best of his ability, with the spectrum of gas in the lab, which would give you bright lines. Right? And he then said that some of these dark lines and bright lines did seem to coincide, to the best of his experimental ability. Therefore, he postulated that maybe one could then infer the substance on the sun from their spectra. But this was just a postulate, and nobody really took much notice of this. So the origin of these Fraunhofer dark lines of the sun continued to remain a mystery, even though these people had some inkling of maybe what was going on. Okay, just more speculation than any proof. The first definitive idea from any experiment came from Foucault, the guy behind the Foucault's pendulum, which proved that the Earth was actually rotating on its own axis. There's a Foucault's pendulum in Ayuka in Pune, if any of you have been there. What he did was he took an electric arc, and he saw the spectrum from electric arc. If you look at the spectrum from electric arc, the substance in the electric arc will give you bright lines like this. This we'll come to this line again and again. This is called the D line of sodium. And the D line of sodium actually made the history of spectroscopy very complicated for decades, because sodium as salt was present everywhere. So any chemical they looked at had minute trace of salt, and therefore they would get this D line in LO for every chemical. And therefore, at least 20 years, chemists were confused as to what is happening until they cleared out the fact that it was sodium, which had to be removed very carefully from everything they had. Now, if you looked at the arc with sodium in it, Foucault figured out that you could see a bright line of sodium. And then if you look at the sun directly through a spectroscope, you could see a rainbow with these dark lines. And the dark line and the bright line, he could show were indeed coincident in wavelength. Then what he did was he passed sunlight through the arc. And he opened the slit such that the sunlight was brighter than the arc. So the arc was dimmer than the sunlight. Okay? And then he found that the dark line was stronger, which meant that the sodium in the arc, he said, was absorbing even more of the background sunlight than what is already there in the Fraunhofer line. Now, this was a gigantic clue as to what is happening. Right? Not only did he find exact coincidence for the first time experimentally, he also showed that the sodium in the electric arc, you know, enhanced the Fraunhofer line from the sun, as if, and therefore the process happening here might be happening there too. This was the first clear understanding towards what is going on. So he writes, thus the arc presents us with a medium which emits the D rays, this is the D ray of sodium, on its own account, which is here, and which at the same time absorbs them when they come from another quarter. Okay, so this is the first inkling one had. But, you know, Foucault being Foucault, he told Stokes, he found this. Stokes told Lord Kelvin, and then everybody forgot about it, and nobody really, no, he didn't really publish it, unfortunately, at that time. Parallelly in Germany, Bunsen had invented a Bunsen burner, which all of us had used in schools, right? Now, we all had done something called the flame test, which never worked for me in my high school, where if you introduce a chemical inside the flame, depending on the chemical, the flame color would change, right? So chemists were using this to identify which chemical was in which flame, except that certain chemicals gave colors which are very similar. You know, so how do you distinguish the which chemical was which if one was bluish green, other was slightly less bluish green, and so on. But then Bunsen invented the Bunsen burner, which made things a lot clearer, and therefore one could actually identify chemicals through the characteristic color very well, uncontaminated from the source of the flame itself. But the problem still remained that not all colors were easily distinguished. Now, Gustav Kirchhoff was working with Bunsen in Heidelberg, came up with a brilliant idea. He said, we know that the problem is that two different slightly bluish-green colors in the flame cannot be distinguished by eye. Let us pass them through a prism or a grating, and then we can probably separate the colors much better by measuring the wavelength of the light as to where exactly they fall in the spectrum. Okay? Now, all this seems obvious to us in hindsight, but at this time, all this was arrived at with laborious work and insight at that time in the 1800s. Okay? So he said, why don't I connect the prism to the flame? And then they did that. In 1859, they were able to identify elements by their bright spectral lines using a prism exactly. And this was, in some sense, the beginning of chemical spectroscopy. Okay? And they had a lasting collaboration which went on for 30, 40 years in Heidelberg, and they did a lot of things together, and I'll talk about them a bit more. He then what Kirchhoff did was to take off from Fraunhofer, and he passed incandescent line, just a flame through a prism, and you find bright line, right? You burn a chemical in a flame, you get a bright light, you pass through a prism, you get bright spectral lines due to the element in the flame, right? It's burning in the flame. Then he did what Foucault did. He passed sunlight through the flame, and the sunlight was brighter than the flame. And then he found that there were dark lines, which are coincident with the bright lines. Now, he did that for sodium. He knew where sodium lines were. Everybody knew sodium lines. The D line is very, very bright, yellow, right? And therefore, then he saw sodium dark lines, because the sodium in the flame absorbed the remaining sodium light, the light at the sodium wavelength in the sun, and therefore, you got an even darker line than usual. Okay, but then he knew what the lithium line looked like in the lab. Okay, and he also knew that there was no lithium dark line in the Fraunhofer spectrum, right? And therefore, he passed sunlight through a flame where he burnt lithium, and he could produce a lithium Fraunhofer line. Now, this was for him reasonable proof. He could produce a Fraunhofer line at will, right? Therefore, he inferred that the sun therefore had sodium in it, but it had no lithium, right? Therefore, he and Bunsen wondered, could one sit in the earth, on earth in a lab, and without touching the sun, could you actually tell what was in the sun, what the sun was made of? At that time, this was a revolutionary idea. Okay, a lot of people laughed at them for years and years and years, for even thinking that one could do so. Right? And there was a famous fire at Mannheim, which was visible from Heidelberg at that time. And they could see the fire, and therefore they trained the spectroscope towards Mannheim, and they could identify the elements burning in the fire in Mannheim, which they could go and verify. And they said, okay, if I can do it for Mannheim, why can't I do it for the sun, was the question they asked. So, there was a quotation which is there in a Nature paper, so it's true, where Kirchhoff apparently says, Bunsen, I have gone mad. And Bunsen says, yeah, so have I, Kirchhoff. This was in the context of them realizing that just like they could identify elements in Mannheim from a fire, they could probably sit on Earth and identify elements on the sun itself, right? So then they wrote in a paper, the dark lines originate from the presence of the substance in the solar atmosphere, which cause bright lines in the same place as the spectrum of flame. So if you have chemicals in a flame, it causes bright lines in the spectrum at certain wavelengths or certain colors. And the same lines on the sun absorb the background sunlight and cause dark lines at the same colors or wavelengths, and which are Fraunhofer lines. And this was now conclusively proved because they could measure the angles and the wavelengths exactly. That's what Kirchhoff and Bunsen did. Okay? And now what they did, they went one step further than Foucault did, which was to kind of put forth a mathematical theory, which is kind of the start of thermodynamics in terms of in this context. So Kirchhoff then said, any hot opaque source will emit all colors, like a rainbow, right? Like most of this light does, right? Or if you heat, iron or something very, very, to very hot temperatures, any hot opaque source will emit a continuous spectrum of all colors, like a rainbow. Any hot thin gas will emit only discrete lines at specific colors, and which colors they emit depends on which gas it is, as in what the gas is composed of. Now, the third thing he said was, if you cool the gas and put it in front of the hot source, at the same location as the hot gas was emitting bright colored lines, it will now absorb those lines from this spectrum and will give you dark lines, which are Fraunhofer lines, right? So this is understanding they put forth very clearly after all these experiments. And the story behind this involves around 30 years of work involving all these people, okay? He also put forth something else is not relevant to my talk. I'm just going to put it out there because a lot of people here would be interested. He also developed a mathematical theory, which at that time nobody understood. Even Faraday said, this is too complicated, I don't understand this theory. Now, when he presented at the Royal Society, he said any opaque substance that absorbs all radiation falling on it will also emit at all colors. And this radiation he called black body emission. And he claimed, using arguments, that this radiation is universal in nature. It does not depend on which substance it is. That is, the rainbow colors, which are incandescent, many hot source emits, does not depend on what the source is, but is universal. It depends only on the temperature of the substance. Okay, so this rainbow color, he said, was independent of what the source was, as long as it was opaque and incandescent and in thermodynamic equilibrium, right? He said that in so many words. Only if it is thin will it emit spectra. And then he said this black body, and then he said the emission in a spectral line is proportional to the absorption in the dark line, and the ratio of these two, he said, is also the same black body emission. And that's how the thermodynamics and optics became related, but that's a story for another day. Now, this theory he put forth caused a lot of confusion. Nobody understood it. Everybody said this was rubbish. And it took a long time for people to understand and realize the importance of this theory. Okay? Now, based on his theory and observation, Kirchhoff therefore concluded that the sun must have a hot core surrounded by a cool atmosphere, just like this. And the cool atmosphere around the hot core is emitting light like this at all colors. And the cool atmosphere, the sun, is then absorbing light at the colors corresponding to the elements present on the sun, thereby giving us these Fraunhofer lines. And this is actually a spectrum published by Kirchhoff in 1840s, where he's written down the elements he's identified on the sun. This is solar spectrum, okay? Therefore, he said, look, the atmosphere of the sun has hydrogen, magnesium, calcium, nickel, copper, chromium, barium, iron, and so on. So he said, I could see all these elements on the sun's atmosphere. Now, this went against the prevalent opinion at that time, which now sounds very silly. The prevalent opinion at that time, the astronomers, was that the sun was made of a cool solid or liquid surrounded by a hot atmosphere. Okay? And they said sunspots, which you see as dark spots of sun, are holes through which you see this dark liquid inside the sun. And Kirchhoff said, no, it's the opposite of what you think. The sun, instead of having a cold core and a hot core and a cold atmosphere, actually has a cold core and a hot atmosphere. And this was different from what people thought. Okay. Now, when he said all this and published these spectra, the news of this spread across Europe. In fact, he published this result on the same year Darwin's book came out. But one could argue Darwin's book was a bit more revolutionary than Kirchhoff's idea. And then using this technique of isolating elements by spectra, he even discovered cesium and rubidium in the laboratory. Crookes discovered thallium. So chemistry had changed now. Chemistry initially was by measuring weights, then it started using electrolysis, and now chemistry started using spectra to discover new elements now. Okay, so chemistry itself had changed now. And now, but Kirchhoff's theory had an important prediction. Remember, Kirchhoff's theory was that sun had a hot core with a cool atmosphere. The hot core emits all colors, and the cool atmosphere absorbs some of the colors depending on the elements present in the atmosphere. Now, if you take the atmosphere of the sun and put it somewhere else, then that doesn't have a hot core behind it. Therefore, they should now start emitting those dark lines as bright lines instead, just like you see in the flame in the laboratory. So he said, if you look at the atmosphere of the sun by itself, the lines should reverse. The dark line should become bright. This was his prediction. Okay? Now, how do we do this? You can't take the sun's atmosphere and put it outside and see, right? But people quickly realize there's an excellent way to do this. Namely, a total solar eclipse. During a total solar eclipse, the moon covers the sun's disk, and therefore the hot core is completely covered, exposing what at that time they thought was the atmosphere, which is the corona, which you see here, and these dark flares, which we now know as prominences and flares, they were called red flames at that time. Okay, they thought the red flame and the corona was the sun's atmosphere, and therefore if you train your spectroscopic slit on this atmosphere during a total solar eclipse, then the dark lines you usually see as Fraunhofer lines should suddenly reverse and become bright lines instead, right? So that was the idea. And that's what Kirchhoff said, right, would happen. And if it happened, then his entire theory would be proved right. Now, let's take a digression at this point and look at what the sociological scene of astronomy was. Professional astronomers at that time thought astronomy was about mapping how bodies moved in the sky, namely celestial mechanics or positional astronomy, right? So Airy, George Airy, was the royal astronomer, the head of the Greenwich Observatory. He was the biggest astronomer in England. He said at this time, what astronomy is expected to accomplish is at all times the same. It may lay down rules by which movements of the celestial bodies as they appear to us upon Earth can be computed. All else which we may learn respecting these bodies, as for example, their appearance and the character of their surface, is indeed not undeserving of attention, but possesses no proper astronomical interest. Okay. Otto Struve, another famous astronomer, one of the most famous astronomers in America at that time, said, God forbid that astronomy should be carried away by a fascination with novelty and diverge from the essential base of positional astronomy. Okay. The situation is exactly opposite. When I did my PhD in astronomy, I did not even have a course on positional astronomy because it was considered outdated and irrelevant. And all my courses were on spectroscopy, right? So the position is exactly the opposite now. And a lot of this came from, at that time, what is called positivism put forth by this philosopher in France called Comte, Comte actually said that, you know, science should rely on what you can observe and measure. And therefore, you know, he said a prime example of what science should not or cannot do is to sit on Earth and tell you what the sun is made of, because that is against what science is all about. So that was the understanding at that time, you know, even philosophically. Now, this was called new astronomy. This whole spectroscopy thing was new astronomy, and everybody was looking down upon it. The professionals did not like it at all. In fact, astronomical spectroscopy was developed almost completely by amateur astronomers in the 1800s, namely William and Margaret Huggins, Lockyer, Janssen, Secchi, and we'll talk about all of them soon. Okay? They are the ones who built their own telescopes. They are the ones who, fascinated by Kirchhoff's ideas, built their own spectroscopes and started studying spectra from stars. In fact, the observatory started, some people complained that if you go to these amateur observatories, they look more like chemistry labs than observatory. Observatories had transit circles and meridional telescopes and, you know, huge gears, whereas their observatories had, you know, chemistry labs, because they had to compare the spectra from stars with the spectra of elements. So they had crucibles and Bunsen burners and you know, reagents and so on. And therefore, these amateur astronomers were the first to actually start doing spectroscopy, whereas professional astronomers were doing only positional astronomy. Now, the situation is exactly opposite. Amateur astronomers these days, the last 100 years, only do positional astronomy. They look at how things move, they photograph the skies, and professionals do spectroscopy. So now things are completely reversed as well, right? So that's about sociology of astronomy in some sense, which is kind of interesting in itself. So let's start meeting some of these prominent amateur astronomers. William Huggins was a silk merchant in UK. He came upon a telescope. He discovered telescopes at some point late in his life. He thought it was fascinating. He gave up his job. He built his own observatory at home. And then he married Margaret Huggins. And with a neighbor who was a chemist called Miller, he started looking at spectra. One of the first people to do so. Okay? He wrote, when he started looking at spectra, this is him with his telescope, he built his own spectroscope to be attached to a telescope. He said, I felt as if I had now the power to lift a veil which had never been before lifted, as if a key had been put into my hands which would unlock a door which had been regarded as forever closed to man. The door was knowing what material any object in the sky was made of sitting on Earth. Right? This is Margaret Huggins. He was the first to photograph spectra of stars in the world. This amateur astronomer sitting at home after giving up his silk merchant business. He photographed spectra of 50 stars and matched them to a library of chemical spectra he had developed in his own home with Miller. Right? In fact, he had better quality spectra than Greenwich Observatory. Greenwich Observatory would come to him for spectra because they had much poorer instruments than he did. Okay? Of course, he even looked at a cat's eye nebula and he discovered nebulae made of hot gas. That's a famous discovery he made himself. The second person who we'll see repeatedly is Pierre Janssen. Janssen was a Frenchman. He had no schooling. He had a limp, which is important because he was one of the first globe-trotting astronomers. Okay? The story of Janssen and how he was a globe-trotting astronomer is a topic for a different talk, and at some point you guys should hear it. He went all over the world following transits of Venus, of Mercury, of eclipses to do various things. He never got academic position because he fought, the people in the Paris Observatory did not like him. There was a political issue. And therefore he was supported by the Bureau de Longitude instead of the Paris Observatory. He never got an academic position because of politics. Instead, he kept getting grants through the Bureau of the Longitude, and therefore he did astronomy, including all his travels. Okay? He became very soon the maker of the best spectroscopes in the world. So anybody wanted quality spectroscope, including observatories, they had to come to Janssen in France and get it from. This is a picture of one of the spectroscopes. Okay? And he was convinced by 1863 that the total solar eclipse was the best event to prove Kirchhoff. And Janssen was one of the people, and Lockyer, who we'll see later, were one of the people who pushed the professional astronomers into investing time and money into following Kirchhoff's idea. I also wanted to mention Janssen for another reason. People don't know, I just trained Warren and Warren didn't know either. Everybody thinks that cinema was invented by Lumiere brothers. That's wrong. Okay. So Janssen was following up another thing called the transit of Venus, which is again a story by itself for a different talk. A transit of Venus is when Venus comes between the sun and the earth. Okay, so it's like an eclipse, except Venus is very, very small, so it moves across the sun's disk. And all colonial countries were sending expeditions across the world to measure the transit of Venus, because that was a way they had to measure the distance of the entire universe they knew at that time. Okay, the way you would measure the universe was measure transit of Venus. That was an incredibly important scientific expedition, and people went across the world, including India, to measure them. There was a technical problem with this, and therefore Janssen wanted to take a series of very quick photographs as Venus just entered the sun's limb. And just a few years before that, Colt had invented its revolver, the pistol revolver. Motivated by the revolver, he adapted the technology whereby he made a large instrument whereby you could take photographs very, very quickly on a rotating circle. And that became the first cinematograph. Lumiere brothers saw his idea, copied it, modified it, and then made the first cinematograph, which they then exhibited famously in Lyon. And after 2 years, it came to India, and Bombay also had its first cinema, right? In the one of the movies Lumiere brothers had premiered in Lyon, Janssen appears because they invited him because, you know, they took the idea from him. And the first movie we have ever made is not by Lumiere, was by Janssen, of Venus entering the sun. That's Venus. And this, as far as I know, is the first movie we ever have. And astronomy gave it to us. Please remember, when you go to Satyam Theatre, remember, astronomy gave us cinema. Okay. Anyway, moving on. The other amateur astronomer who played a huge part was Father Angelo Secchi. Secchi was the head of the Vatican Observatory. And why was there a Vatican Observatory, again, is a story by itself. He was introduced to spectroscopy by Janssen. And then he took to it in a very big way. And he said, research in precise astronomy, he means positional astronomy, measuring the position, motion of planets and stars, was a waste of time and energy. He wondered if he should devote time to studies of the physical appearance of the sun and other celestial bodies using spectra. He then went on to observe 4,000 stellar spectra, and he was the first to make a library of stellar spectra, and he was the first to try and classify spectra, because each star seemed to have a different spectrum. So he tried to classify them into 5 categories. And that is a different story by itself, because then that was taken up. You notice that most of the people I mentioned are white men. Okay, there are very few women in the story, except Margaret Huggins. The story which follows this goes to Harvard, where Pickering employed only women. They were very disparagingly called Pickering's harem, but they were technically called computers. And all we know of stellar class spectra now comes from these women, you know, Henrietta Leavitt, Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin, Wilhelmina, and so on. And following them is a story which has an Indian connection, I'll tell you in a bit. Okay. The next person is Norman Lockyer. Lockyer was a clerk in the UK War Office. Okay. And he used to write popular science articles to pass his time and to make some money, like I do now. He came across a telescope by chance at some neighbor's place. He got fascinated by it, bought his own telescope, got from Huggins a spectroscope, and within 5 years started making phenomenal discoveries. Okay? He writes, may not the spectroscope afford us evidence of the existence of red flame? Red flames are these prominences of flares erupting from the sun, which total eclipses have revealed to us in the sun's atmosphere, although they escape all other methods of observation at other times. He came up along with Huggins independently of an idea. He said, why do you want to wait for an eclipse to look at the sun's atmosphere and see Kirchhoff was right? If I put a spectroscope outside the sun's limb and do it very carefully, even during normal times, I should be able to see the bright lines. And then there's and he gave some technical reasons why one could do so. And he tried for years and years to get this done. And later he and Huggins had a huge fight, huge falling out. They were best friends at some point. They had a huge falling out about for credit for this idea. And we'll come to this again. But a lot of difficulties in making the idea, implement the idea. He had to ask someone to make the telescope for him. That guy went out of business. He asked somebody else, and so on and so forth. And we'll come back to it. Now let's go to the eclipse itself. Therefore, all this tells you by 1860s, everybody, both amateur astronomers by their proof and professional astronomers because of the vast evidence the amateurs collected, were convinced that the total solar eclipse was the best way to see if Kirchhoff was right or wrong. And by now, I don't realize Kirchhoff's idea was important to test. Okay. So Major Tennant, who was the East India Company, he was involved with the Great Trigonometric Survey of India, which also deserves a talk by its own because, again, it started in Madras. The Trigonometric Survey of India was, it still remains the largest scientific experiment of its time. It went on for 70 years, involved some 100,000 men. Around 10,000 men died during the survey itself. It mapped the entire country. It discovered Everest was the tallest mountain, along with Kanchenjunga and so on. The first baseline measured by Lambton for the survey was between St. Thomas Mount and a small hillock just south of Perumbakkam. Okay, so it started in Madras, in fact. And so he was with the survey. He was in the army during the 1857 independence war, mutiny, revolt, whatever you want to call it. He was there capturing Kashmiri Gate back from the Indians. He was there in Lucknow during quelling of the Lucknow rebellion, as they called it. But during fighting Indians in Lucknow, he spent half his time looking at the instruments in the Lucknow Observatory and wrote about that instead. He then calculated the precise part of totality which was going to occur on 18th August 1868, 150 years from tomorrow. And this eclipse was going to last for 6 minutes totality. And that's a large amount. Usually they last for a minute or two. Now, to test Kirchhoff's idea, you need to put a spectroscope on the edge of the sun. And to do that, at that time, technology they had would take time. And therefore, a 6 minute long total solar eclipse was fantastic. They had enough time to test the idea of Kirchhoff, right? But of course, August, as we know in India right now, like this year, it's monsoon. Therefore, you know, one had to figure out where you would have clear skies in August. He then sat and he laboriously calculated the path of totality. This is a map from Tennant, which this band is a path of totality. And he then identified Guntur and Machilipatnam in present-day Andhra Pradesh as the best places to observe the eclipse. You also taking into account weather factors, okay? He also gave a list of things to do. He said, put a spectrum here, do it this way. He said, take photographs. Astronomy photography was only 6 years old by then. And he also asked him to take polarization, which I won't talk about, but that's a story by itself, okay? Now, I went to SkyCalc and found the path again of the eclipse. This is the path of the eclipse. And this is the midline. This totality is from here to here, okay? This passes through from Karnataka to Andhra. And if you blow it up, this is the path. This is Guntur town, present-day Guntur town and present-day Machilipatnam town, which is where he suggested people go and put up telescopes to observe. Okay. So now England and France officially decided to send teams to India to observe the eclipse because this was now seen as something important scientifically, plus, you know, prestige, colonial powers, and so on and so forth, right? So Major Tennant was sent with a fully equipped team with the best telescopes, spectroscopes possible by the Royal Astronomical Society in England to Guntur. Janssen managed to get funds independently because Paris Observatory refused to fund him, they didn't like him, to go to Guntur as well, okay? John Herschel, the son of William Herschel who discovered Uranus, both his sons were in India. One of them was working with the Great Trigonometric Survey. He told him to go and do the same thing with a spectroscope. He went to Jamkandi in Karnataka. Okay. The other son stayed in India and went on to discover and perfect the technique of fingerprinting of humans, by the way. So that's, you know, aside. Lockyer stayed back in UK, but he tried to perfect his method of trying to see the spectrum, bright lines of prominences and flares, or the red flames, without an eclipse. Ray was sent by the French for a government formally, the huge team to Malacca, to see the eclipse on 18 August 1868. Okay. Now comes our hero, the actual hero of the story, Norman Pogson. All this was being watched by Norman Pogson with extreme sadness and despondency and irritation from Madras. Now, Madras Observatory is the second observatory outside Europe ever. The first was in Jakarta by the Dutch. Okay, William Petrie, who was the officer of the East India Company, had started his own personal observatory in Egmore, which after 5 years he gave to East India Company, who then made it a formal observatory. The current place is the Nungabakkam Met Station near Kuvam. Okay, that used to be the site. Even now, there's a pillar there marking the fact that Madras Observatory started there in early 1800s, 1802 or something. In 1870, it shifted to Kodaikanal, became the Kodaikanal Solar Observatory, and now it is the current Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore. So Madras Observatory is a very, very historic observatory, and that again should be a talk by itself. Okay. So Poxon was a director or the astronomer at Madras Observatory in Nungapakkam. He did, before coming here, he in Oxford, he had come up with a system of classifying, measuring stellar brightness called magnitudes, and that system we still use today, okay, what Poxon did. But the problem was Poxon did not go to Oxford or Cambridge. He went to a small college somewhere, okay. Because of that, the prominent astronomers in UK looked down upon him, just plain snobbery, like we do here with, you know, IITs and IIMs, I suppose, right. So they did not like him. They thought he was this, you know, this guy from a small non-Oxford Cambridge college, and therefore they did not like him much. They sent him off to Madras. In Madras, they refused to fund him. He was complaining constantly about funding and support. They did not support him. George Airy, who was Astronomer Royal, did not like him because George Airy thought any astronomer worth his name should have at least a Wrangler in Oxford. And so he did a lot of amazing work. He discovered six asteroids from Madras. He surveyed the entire southern sky secretly because he wasn't allowed to do so officially. He made Atlas of variable stars and so on. And he complained constantly about not being allowed to do anything. He was refused funding to see the eclipse to measure the spectrum. He asked for it, he refused funding. He obtained a spectroscope from Huggins personally as a friend. And he went off to Machilipatnam under pretext setting up a met station because Machilipatnam had a cyclone two years ago. Okay. He also sent Chintamani Raghunathachari, who was a very famous fellow, to Vanapurthi to observe the eclipse. This again deserves a talk by itself. Raghunathachari was the first modern Indian astronomer. He was at Madras Observatory. And he was the first modern Indian science popularizer, astronomy popularizer. And he's the first person to change Indian astronomy tables by actual observations. And so, no, that's something by itself to talk about. Anyway, so all this happened. So 18th August dawned. 9 a.m. was the start of totality. Everybody had set up their telescopes everywhere in Guntur, Machilipatnam, Jamkandi, Vanapurthi, Malacca, and so on. And totality, this is the photograph of that totality by Tennant, and this is a sketch of Tennant's cap. They saw this bright red flame or a prominence, a flare which erupted from the sun's surface. So all of them independently turned their spectroscopes towards this flame. Okay, what did they find? All of them, Janssen, Tennant, Herschend, Poxon, Andre, saw that they were bright lights. So Kirchhoff was right after all. So they proved Kirchhoff right. So what was dark till totality became bright lines in the spectrum when they put their slit on this prominence, on this red flame. Tennant writes back, suddenly it burst into sight, a gloriously brilliant linear spectrum. One line in red was so beautiful, that's a hydrogen line, that needed an effort to turn his attention to anything else. There was a line in the orange, and this is important, not so well defined, and one in green which seemed multiple. Herschel writes back, I consider that there can be no question that the orange line was identical with D. D is the alloyne of sodium, remember. We come back to it again and again. So far as the capacity of the instrument to establish any such identity is concerned. Janssen from Guntur notes the bright yellow line that was D, and this is important. Okay? So all of them saw the hydrogen red line, a blue line, and the yellowish orange line, and they all said the yellowish orange line is a D line of sodium. But Poxon had a doubt. Poxon was not sure. Poxon says in his report, the third line seen order of brilliancy must have been either coincident with or very near the place of sodium line D. And that, this phrase is the key phrase for the whole thing. Okay, so he sent a report, but it's not published because they didn't want to publish him. So he sent the report anyway to everybody. And this key phrase is lost to history till Biman kind of dug it up and published a book in 2013. This is Poxon's hand drawing of what he saw that day. This is the D line, and this is the bright line he saw, which was coincident or very near D. Okay. Lockyer heard about all of this, all these reports, but he mixed up Poxon's near D with Janssen's report, and he kept telling everybody Janssen said this. Okay. Now, after the eclipse, the day, just an hour after the eclipse ended, Janssen had a thought, had an idea. He said, okay, let me try what Lockyer's been talking about. I know where the red flame is exactly on the sun. I know which angle, which side of sun the red flame is. Let me come tomorrow, and then because sun will be the right, at the same angle, let me put my spectroscope at that same angle, and then outside the sun's limb and see if I see the bright line. Okay? So he did this. The next day at 10 o'clock, he did this, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, and he saw the bright line again. And this is supreme irony because he had come all the way to India, right? Because of 6 minutes of totality where I see the bright line. The next day, no eclipse, he saw the line again because he knew exactly what to do. He writes back, They sent me to observe the eclipse of 5 minutes, and I'm bringing back with them the perpetual eclipse of India. Perpetual eclipse because he could now see the line at any time by training the spectrograph outside the limb in a particular way. I mean, there are some details to it, but I won't. No, that's different. So he dashed out a paper to the French Academy and continued to observe it from Shimla. He went to Shimla, and then from Shimla, he started continued to observe the spectrum of the bright line spectrum of the atmosphere of the sun continuously anyway, for the next 2 or 3 months. Lockyer got his telescope done by the guy who then he was ill, and then he got up and he made the telescope, sent it to Lockyer. Lockyer got it 20th October, a few couple of months after the eclipse. He immediately, he went to war office late that morning because he went in the morning, instead of going to the war office, he went and, as he said, fished around the limb of the sun. He didn't know where the red flame was. He fished around the limb of the sun till he found a place where he saw bright lines too, without the eclipse, including D. And he sent, and he also said it's D, and he sent off a report to the French Academy. Remember, Janssen sent off a report the day after the eclipse on 19th August, and Lockyer sent it off on 20th October. Okay, they both, because, and this is something our postal service hasn't improved even now, I guess, even 2018, they both appeared at the French Academy on the same day within 2 hours of each other. Okay, so the French Academy decided to give them both credit, equal credit, and they made this medal in honor of Janssen and Lockyer for a method to get the spectrum of the solar atmosphere without an eclipse. This is important. This is what they got the medal for. This somehow got mixed up with discovering the near D line, and then everybody started thinking they got the medal for discovering the helium line. It is not. Okay? All this was cleared up by Bhima's book. Chandrasekhar was the only one who had kind of had an inkling, and he had noticed, and he said, the Poisson's near D phrase is important, he had mentioned somewhere, okay? Which Bhima got hold of, and then he wrote the whole book about it, setting everything right. Therefore, the first person to notice the line seen at the eclipse was not the D line, but near it was actually Poisson from Madras Observatory, and not Janssen or Tennant or Herschel. By the way, unfortunately, Raghunathachari, who went to Vanapurti, it was completely cloudy, so he couldn't see the eclipse at all, unfortunately. Else, he would also be in the first Indian to see the helium line. But anyway. So, no, is it D or near D? The next few months, Janssen and Lockyer could see the line, bright lines, anytime they wanted, and they confirmed that the line was not sodium, was not the D line. The D line was two lines, they called D1, D2, they called it D3. So D3 line was not the sodium line. They confirmed it over the next few months. And now they could see an emission regularly by their new method they had got the metal for. So what was it? Lockyer thought that D3 line was a new element. Okay? Everybody else thought, no, it is an unknown line of another element we have, because why would you want to have a new element? That seemed a bit far-fetched. Okay, Lockyer started working with Franklin, a chemist, to track down this line. So they started taking any chemical they could find and looking at the spectrum to try and identify this D3 line, which was seen in the sun routinely. No, but they could not. And in fact, Lockyer named this element helium because helios means sun in Greek. Okay. Meanwhile, astronomers started discovering new lines from the sky which are not seen on the Earth. So they started giving new names for elements. They said, oh, there's coronium, there's nebulium, there is asterium, there's orionium, and so on. So it became embarrassing at some point, right? And so what were they? Were they actually new elements? A huge controversy across Europe. Were they new elements? Were they unknown lines of known elements, and so on? There's a lot of controversy, bitter rivalries. People started fighting with each other, and so on. And in fact, Lockyer was the main guy he was doing. Lockyer is very aggressive, incredibly, and he pissed off everybody in Europe. So somebody wrote, and Lockyer gets cockier and cockier, for he thinks he's the owner of the solar corona. Okay, you know who said this? Maxwell. So the fight was all over Europe. Okay. Now, what on earth was helium? People were trying to find helium, and on Earth they could not find it. Right. So now, by now, helium was also now discovered in Nova Cygni, erupting star. Discovered in Orion Nebula. It was discovered in blue stars, in white stars. So helium seemed to be found in many places in the sky, but it refused to be found on Earth. Okay, in any chemistry lab. So there are many theories put forth over the next 20 years. Some people thought helium was a primal element from which everything was made of. So since outside the universe, helium was still there, helium combines to form other elements like we have on Earth, therefore there's no helium on Earth. People thought maybe everything was a multiple of hydrogen, atomic weight roughly. Maybe helium is 0.5, and therefore everything is made of helium, and therefore helium, when it's hot, it's in everything is helium. When it gets cold, it combines to form hydrogen, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon. There are various things put forward by chemists. None of them really worked out. There were a lot of fights about it. Lockyer had some inclination. He said, look at all the stars. Each stellar spectrum seems to be different, right? If you look at the dark lines, we had dark Fraunhofer lines in every star now, right? And people are cataloging it. Seki, remember, had 4,000 stellar spectra he had cataloged. Each stellar spectrum looked different, right? So dark lines were all in different places and different stars. So people thought each star had different elements in different ratios. Lockyer said, maybe not, because in the lab, at different temperatures, the same elements seem to have different spectral lines. At different pressure, they seem to have different spectral lines. So Lockyer said, maybe the stars don't have different abundances of elements. Maybe they have different temperatures. But nobody believed it. People thought he was, again, people fought. You know, remember Maxwell's poem. This turned out to be right. In fact, there's another Indian connection to it. It had to wait till Meghnad Saha came up with this ionization formula. He combined thermodynamics and quantum mechanics, and he came up with a formula whereby from ratio of the spectral line brightnesses, if you take two spectral lines and see how bright they were, from the ratios, you could then deduce the temperature and density of the gas emitting it. That's what Saha did, for which he became very famous. Cecilia Payne Gaposchkin, working in the US, used Saha's formula in her PhD thesis and proved that stars differ not by element abundance or how much of each element they have, but instead by temperature, using Saha's formula. Okay? She also proved in her thesis that the main constituent of the universe is hydrogen. People thought that the Earth's composition was the universe's composition. Okay? So she was the first one to prove it in her thesis. So in fact, somebody had said that this was the most momentous PhD thesis ever written in the history. Payne Gaposchkin was 1920s, 1930s. So she based her work on Saha's equation, applied it to all the spectra and the work done by all the women computers of Harvard Observatory. So that's a different topic. So the huge debate, right? Many people, including Mendeleev, refused to consider a new element, right? Even Lockyer later changed his mind about it because he wasn't finding it on Earth. In the meantime, around 1880s, Rayleigh had discovered argon when you look at nitrogen, he seems to think nitrogen had some other gas mixed in it. So with a lot of difficulty, he extracted a second element and he discovered argon. And he found that argon was a new element in the periodic table. They had to find a new column for it. And it was an inert gas. It did not react with anything at all. And now people said, okay, if I have one element like that, I want to find other elements in that same column, other inert gases or noble gases. People started looking for other gases, right? Now, Ramsay isolated a gas from Cleveite. This is a photograph of the bottle of Cleveite he actually did isolate the gas from. And Ramsay was trying to, in fact, Ramsay went on to find every other element in that, every other noble gas, okay? And he got Nobel Prize for helium. He found a gas from Cleveite in 1895, and he found that it had an unusual spectrum with a bright line at 588. 588 is our D3 line of helium people have been searching for 27 years. He wrote, there's argon in the gas from Cleveite, but there's a magnificent yellow line, brilliantly bright, not coincident with, but very close to a sodium yellow line. I was puzzled, but began to smell a rat. So he wrote to Crookes, saying, look, this is what I found. It's a line at 588 nanometers, not sodium, and here's a sample. And he gave a sample to them freely and saying, you please analyze it yourself. Okay, that's not something we do these days very easily. Now, Crookes immediately said this, and he was looking for krypton at that time. Crookes said, this is the line of helium. Then he sent a telegram to Ramsay saying, krypton is helium, come and see. Okay, so then Ramsay went to Crookes' house and saw it for himself. So this is the long sought for D3 line of helium. Helium was now discovered on Earth 27 years after being seen on the sun from Machalipatnam. He got Nobel Prize for it in 1904 as well. In which he said he attributed wrongly the discovery to Janssen, which I started off with. Okay, so this is the story of helium. Okay, so ultimately helium was tracked down to Earth. Helium was found on Earth. Now, of course, once it was found, it was then cleared. It's a noble gas, didn't react to anything, and its properties, chemical properties, started explaining things like why is it found in stars, why not on Earth, why only as a bright line on Sun, why not as a dark line on Sun, why only in hot stars. All that got cleared up once people understood the chemistry of helium. Now, of course, and this was in some sense the beginning of spectroscopy. After this, things were clear, right? Now, things were clear that any new spectral line could be identified with an element, temperature mattered, and so on and so forth. And astronomical spectroscopy just took off from there. And now, of course, we've come a long, long way since then. We identified incredibly complex molecules in space. This is a spectrum of towards the star of in the infrared of molecules. You can see each one is a complex molecule. We have, we have spectra of multiple spectra of gas between galaxies, which tells us how the universe got reionized. So we come a long, long way. But all of this, which we routinely do in observatories these days, started in some sense with the story of helium, because that's what gave the astronomers the confidence and the knowledge of applying spectroscopy to what is in the sky. So is such a story unusual? I'm going to end in a couple of minutes. This story has twists and turns. I talked about rivalries, fights, things not being clear as to who said what first. Did somebody say something and discover it, or somebody said something which seemed a bit like what somebody said later, and so on. But that, one would argue, is how science actually is, right? In textbooks, we learn a very wrong, false history of science. Textbooks, we say, oh, somebody had a hypothesis, he did this experiment, then he found this result, we said, oh, Eureka! And then he found something, and then we name it after him and read it in textbooks and answer a question like that. That's not how science actually works, right? In principle, science is not linear. Science, we tend to look at the past as romanticized science, like, you know, into a hero plus Eureka moment. That's not true. All ideas are collaborative. You know, if you remember, Talbot said something very similar to what Talbot said, Herschel, Foucault, all said something very similar to what Kirchhoff said, but Kirchhoff was able to show it and prove it with measurements. And then, you know, and then later Lockyer said something like Huggins, like Janssen, but then, you know, and so ideas keep coming from different sources and slowly build up into something which then becomes definite and proven, right? So ideas don't occur to one person in one place and then get proven. We also tend to distort history. We look back, we distort it, maybe accidentally, like Ramsey did, maybe purposely because we want to bring fame and glory to ourselves. We also do not note down blind alleys, false turns, failed experiments. And this we know is becoming a huge problem in psychology and medicine these days. There's all these p-value controversies these days, right? We don't note down what experiments did not work. We don't note down what mistakes we made, and so on and so forth, right? We only note down in our textbooks the successful stories. And those get written, of course, in this manner. But now science is much more collaborative, one would argue. And therefore, but similar problems remain, right? But science is much more, at that time, even with some 10 people involved in the story of helium, we saw so much rivalry for credit. I want to end with the fact that today is exactly 1 year. 1 year from today, last year, was this extremely famous event, GW170817. Do you know what it is? It's a gravitational wave from the merging neutron star, which was then seen from in electromagnetic radiation from gamma ray to radio, right? This was revolutionary. This is one of the biggest things that ever happened to astronomy. And it kind of started gravitational wave astronomy as a field by itself. The two papers, the paper announcing the gravitational wave discovery from LIGO and Virgo, and the second paper, which is called the multi-messenger paper, which had all the data from gamma ray to radio, right? These had 1281 and 4155 co-authors. Now, who are you going to give credit to? Right? You can't. There's nobody you can credit to. So science has come along and we do things differently now. But these problems still tend to remain, is the point, right? So the process of science is as much social and political as it is scientific. And I think one thing the story tells us is that incorporating this kind of stories into our textbooks only makes understanding of science and sciences richer and better, rather than painting a false linear history, which is, if you dig a little deep, is not true. That's the moral of the story. I want to end with your take-home gift. Okay, this was designed by Arvind Paranjpai from Ayuka in Pune. So this is a sheet like this. It has a URL of where you can download this sheet and print it yourself on thick paper. It also has a URL printed of a YouTube video which tells you what to do. So you just have to cut along folded lines and then stick them with gum. And then take an old CD of something you don't like anymore. And then put the CD up and then you can make something like this. You have two slits. One slit you face towards the source, and this slit you look through. And this, if you look at this light, you can see a nice linear continuum spectrum from incandescent light. You put some salt in your house onto a flame, you can see the D line momentarily when the salt is burning. If you look at a CFL lamp, you can see emission bands. And if you look at the sun, you can see at least the hydrogen Fraunhofer dark line in the red. Okay. So I said, so after the talk, take one or two. I think there's one for everybody, so you can take one or two if you want. Varun will decide how many people get what, how many. Make it yourself, give it to people, download more, and then just try it for yourself. It's really fun. I think it's fun to do. And you can see all of it yourself. So you can start with Fraunhofer and then, you know, come to the modern age yourself. Okay. So I'll leave you with this modern spectrum of the sun. This is the sun in hydrogen. This is the sun in helium. This is the helium line of the sun taken. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. So Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin, she was a very well-known astronomer. She did a PhD in UK and then US, and she continued to be an astronomer. She trained many students after that. She's very well known. She's an incredibly well known astronomer. And she's one of the people who also did a lot of mentoring of women astronomers, and she's also instrumental in getting many women astronomers in. And personally, another nice piece of tale is that one of her students was Frank Kameny, who was interesting because Frank Kameny was a US astronomer who was fired for being gay. And he ended up being one of the prominent gay rights activists of his time. And recently, Obama instituted an astronomy award in his name, and the American Astronomy Society also recognized him and gave a medal in his name and so on. So a lot of side stories connected to Kaposhkin. Kaposhkin also was instrumental in mentoring a lot of women astronomers on purpose, and that is a thing by itself. Cleveite is called Cleveite because it was isolated by a person called Cleve in Sweden. And in fact, there was a bit of a controversy there because Cleve and his student Langlet in Sweden also claimed to have discovered the helium line from their sample in the lab, but a week after Ramsay did. So they said they should get credit for it. But Ramsay acknowledged them in a Nobel Prize speech, and he acknowledged the fact that they also were co-discoverers. And therefore, in some sense, they were given credit officially. But there was a bit of a fight at some point. It got a bit ugly at some point between Cleve and Langlet and Ramsay. Sorry? Yeah. The light off on the level. This. No, it just wrapped. You take that huge spectrum and just wrap it around to fit on the screen. Yeah. You just go like this. It just wrapped around. Yeah. It's a long strip. It just wrapped around to fit on the screen. It just looks prettier that way. Those are the Fraunhofer dark lines. No, these dark lines are the Fraunhofer lines. Each line is coming from a different element in the sun's atmosphere. Oh, these. Okay. Muslim are bands which, if you zoom in, will be multiple lines. A lot of them are multiple lines. In fact, helium, there was a bit of a controversy again. So when Ramsay discovered helium, and then people started looking at isolating helium in the lab and looking at it, they found that the helium line at 588 nanometers was two lines. Okay. So then they said, oh, then it can't be your D3 line of the eclipse, because eclipse you had one line, this two lines. So again, they said, Locke, here you're wrong. Right? No, those are different. Right? So, and then Lockyer then went back and observed the sun with a better spectroscope, and he showed that the solar line also was double, in fact. So this double line, another story related to that is that when Huggins had his spectra, there was a talk he attended in the Royal Astronomical Society where the Greenwich Observatory people had shown a spectrum, and he said, the magnesium has a huge band of lines and we don't know what it is, a huge band of lines. Lockyer said, no, it's actually made of some 10 lines. And he said, how do you know? He said, I have better spectroscope than you have. So I could see the 10 lines, right? So most of these thick ones are actually a lot of lines pieced together. Yeah. Some lines do get broader because of pressure, but that you won't see in the spectrum. Not in the sun. Yeah. So Raghunathachari, he was, I think, the first Indian modern astronomer in some sense. He was trained by Pogson. He was Pogson's main assistant. And he's a very interesting character. He discovered R reticuli, the variable star. That is what he's most famous for. Most of the observations, Metta's Observatory published, were by him, because he was the main person entrusted by Pogson to do all the observations. So during transit of Venus in 1871, I think, before that, the total solar eclipse, for which he wrote a popular book, explained to the people of India, general public, what an eclipse was and why you should not be scared of it. Okay, so he was in some sense the first astronomy popularizer in India, modern times. And for the transit of Venus, he wrote a popular book explaining the transit of Venus, which he published in English, Tamil, Kannada, Urdu, and one more language, and Persian. Okay, So he was very, and the other big thing he did was that at that time, the Panchanga makers had the predictions for eclipses, right? Now, he had access to modern astronomy tables because he was working at the Madras Observatory. And he knew that the tables the Indian Panchanga makers used were wrong, were out of date, because the data they had used was done by Varahamihira, Bhaskaracharya, et cetera, et cetera. And the Panchanga makers refused to modify the tables because they were God-given by our great sages, and therefore one should not change them. Whereas he said, look, we have these telescopes and observatories. You come and see for yourself. And the tables, the numbers you use are wrong, and you have to update them. And please, these are the new numbers you please use. And they refused. So he actually had he called for a conference of the Panchanga makers and said, let's compare numbers and see what is right. And then he came up with his own modified Panchanga called the Drik Panchanga, which is then became the official Panchanga later. Then the people accepted the Drik Panchanga. And of course, later the calendar reform was done by Meenath Saha after independent India came. But the interesting thing about that, and this is something which was written out for the first time by T. Venkateshwaran of Vijnan Prasar, is that he, for the eclipse, he said, look, I am going to calculate using my techniques of modern astronomy the timing of the total solar eclipse exactly, and how it will appear, which direction the moon will move, and what time it will happen. You have, Panchanga makers have calculated this, and these don't agree. He made both of them public and told the people, all of you, anybody in the public, you go out and you decide for yourself which is right. And in some sense, this is the first time any Indian had said, let people make their own measurements to decide the veracity of traditional or orthodox wisdom. You know? So in that sense, he was very important for all those reasons. That's why I think he's like super. But unfortunately, he the sky was cloudy when he observed the eclipse. Yeah. Yeah, so Venkateshwaran has given a talk on this, and he has a book on the Drik Panchanga thing, which is brilliant. So you should take a look at that. Yeah, so those are just transitions. So when you have atoms ionized or not, when electrons make transition from one level to other, the energy difference is emitted as a photon of the particular wavelength, therefore a particular color. Right. And therefore, and that of course was, so if it's in the radiation field, it'll absorb the line, it absorb that photon, and then exact photon of that wavelength, so it can go to that energy level allowed by quantum mechanics, and then you see a dark line. Instead, if it emits that line, instead if it's already in the higher level, it can emit the line and go to a lower level. And all the confusion about different stellar spectra was because at different temperatures, these atoms got ionized at different levels. And once you ionize them, the energy levels change, therefore the colors and the valence change. That's why all the confusion happened till Saha and Kapochkin came and cleared it up. No, this is not a 2D plot. It's a long strip of spectrum folded back and forth. You should just unfold it and make it a long strip going across the room. That's all. It's a single spectrum from red to blue. It's been folded to look pretty, and so it can fit in the screen. That's all. Yeah. I don't think there are more lines in the blue than red. It depends a lot on the temperature. So this is a solar spectrum, right? So if you look at, so now we classify stars as, it's called OBA, FGKM, and so on. And this is based on the spectrum, but essentially based on temperature. So as the temperature star changes, which atoms exist in which ionization state changes. For example, iron can be ionized up to 13, 14 times in the sun's atmosphere, right? So iron singly ionized, doubly, triply, 4, 5, 6, each of them will give you different lines, so on. So which spectral lines occur in a star depends on temperature a lot. And for this particular temperature of the sun, which is 6,000 Kelvin, if you work out the ionization states of all the elements in the sun's atmosphere, this is the set of spectra you get. But for different temperatures of different stars, you get a different set of spectra and so on. Sorry? Yeah. Yeah. So all of them were traced to ionized states of known elements. Okay. So coronium ended up being iron 13 times ionized. Nebulium turned out to be oxygen triply ionized. Orionium and asterium turned out to be other elements multiply ionized. So all the other lines which were thought to be new elements turned out to be multiply ionized, spectra of multiply ionized known elements, known atoms, all of them. See, because the sun's atmosphere is 6,000. Sun's surface is 6,000. But as you go up, the corona is actually a million degrees. So chromosphere is around 20,000 Kelvin. So you get highly ionized states. You get ions 17, 18 and all that. 18 ionized and all that. As you go higher and higher, because sun's atmosphere is weird. The higher you go, the hotter it gets. And it goes up to million Kelvin. And we still don't know why. We still don't know why the corona is a million degrees. No, Janssen's thing was not, it was few years. I don't remember. So it was during a transit of Venus, I forget when the transit was. It was only a few years. So the Colt revolver was invented, and within a couple of years, he did this thing, and then within a few years, Lumiere did. But because they talked to each other. I'm not sure about the date, but it was a few years between each other. No, this, the 1870s is the eclipse. The transit of Venus, I don't know when it occurred. I forgot. One has to look at it. It's always in a few years of each other. Yeah. Well, it's difficult because, see, the sun is hot because of nuclear fusion in the center. Right, so as you come outward from the sun center, the temperature drops. Right, sun center is like 10 million Kelvin, the surface is 6,000 Kelvin because as radiation comes out, it cools, right, and matter gets hotter. Right, but after some point, when radiation leaves, there's no reason for it to get hotter. What is the energy source for the atmosphere to be hotter than the surface? The atmosphere has to get energy from the surface. The surface is 6,000 Kelvin, right? How do atmosphere just million Kelvin? There's some understanding. The understanding is that these flares we saw at the beginning contribute to heating up the corona due to release of magnetic energy. That is the current understanding. So when these flares, you saw the initial movie, the flares were in loops. Those are actually magnetic loops. If you look at the conditions of density and magnetic field, and you look at the induction equation, you'll figure out that in the sun, the gas is tightly linked to the magnetic field. Where the gas goes, the magnetic field goes. Where the magnetic field goes, the gas goes. Okay. Because of that, when the magnetic field lines come out of the sun and form a loop, the gas also follows the loop. And then when what happens sometimes they pinch and then they reconnect and they erupt as flares. And when they do, the idea is that the energy released is supposed to heat up the corona, but it's not been shown how even now. In fact, 3 days ago, NASA launched a satellite called Parker probe, which is going to dip into the corona for the first time. And one of the main things it's going to do is try and see if we can figure out this is called the coronal heating problem, and there's still no answer. Understanding is that it must be due to magnetic reconnection. But the exact mechanism is still not understood. And if you do simulations in the computers, you still don't get the correct answers. Yeah. So in fact, Lockyer at some point gave up on helium because he got, pissed off with all the drama. He started looking at sunspots. So in fact, I don't know if it was Lockyer or Huggins. One of them actually looked at the sunspot spectrum and he found that the matter was going in and therefore he could, due to Doppler effect and all that. So he could also show that the sunspots was cooler than the surrounding because of the spectrum he found. So they were doing that and you could do that. You just have to, the easiest way to do that at the time was they had to wait till sunspot enter the limb of the sun and then focus the slit on the limb. Nowadays, of course, you can take a spectrum at every point in the sun easily. But that was done by Lockyer and Huggins too. They started doing it. And they showed that the sunspots are cooler. Some people thought sunspots are hotter than the sun. They showed it was cooler. They also showed that the material was going in. And so all the dynamics, they could figure out the Doppler effect and so on and so forth. So, yeah.
Thank you, Rich, not only for this amazing history, but for reminding us that science is full of stories and we should pay more attention.
Thanks. Thank you.